Okay, so good morning. Make sure you're in the right class of the structural stability, but I think I see a lot of you, so it's good. So, my name is Dimitrios Lignos. I am a professor here at the PFL. I think with some of you, we went together on the trip to Chile, right? And, but also the others have seen left and right. So, this class started as a bachelor class in the third year, but because it was the material was fairly challenging, I think from this year became a master's class, and so today I'd like to discuss about the course content, and then you will see what this class is about. And also I'll talk about the course logistics, and that's a 4-credit, so it's not going to be, it will be reasonable, but also it's going to be more than 3-credit, okay, but it's going to be reasonable, okay. So, I'm, for those of you that we've never met, so I was a bachelor student in Athens. I finished in 2003, moved to California for about 7 years, where I did my master's, PhD, postdoc, moved to Japan for another year or so, did another postdoc. Then I spent some time in Montreal for about 5 years, and mostly working on steel structures and behavior under dynamic loading. And then about 4 years ago, I moved to, so now I'm the chair of the Resilient Steel Structure Laboratory. Okay, so what I do is mostly I work on ways that we can understand how buildings behave at large deformations. And in particular, I'm interested about how we can predict the behavior of structures near collapse. So stability is, or instability is the primary focus of what I do. So that's why we did structural stability. I also work on steel, but steel is not just a material that you you've been to some classes and people have told you that steel is like, you know, S235. You get the FY. You do the computations and that's it. Well, steel is much more than this. So we work on with high profile industries with steels that are smart, in the sense that for instance, people have told you that steel needs fire protection. Well, there are steels that you don't need that, and you can leave the surfaces exposed, and aesthetically, this is much better. Also, from a health point of view, it's much better because you don't need to spray chemicals and so on. Or if you are in regions like Switzerland that you get a lot of snow, we have problems with corrosion. So we have steels that are very special for this kind of environments. So again, you don't need to do anything for corrosion because they are fabricated like this, so that these problems are not problems, or they are problems much later. So stability, you could be facing stability problems at the structural level, but you could be facing also stability problems at the component level. So if you are taking, how many of you are taking advanced steel design? Okay. So if you are taking advanced steel design, we are going to learn how we can prevent, by design rules though, this sort of phenomena that obviously compromise the behavior of structural element. And finally, so these problems are all related, but this is a problem related to bridges. Again, this is a connected problem that essentially starts with the instability of this plate and then eventually turns out to fracture. So that's more or less what I do. So if you are interested about semester projects that are more design oriented, we can discuss, or if you are interested about PDMs, again, we can discuss like whenever this time comes. Okay. So today we will talk about the course personnel, course logistics, what you are going to learn from the class, and yeah, why this class is important. And also we are going to do a small review on your statics, but in a way that I like to do. And some of you that have taken the advanced steel design have seen this, but if you, so you will, it will be a small revision, but if you haven't taken the advanced steel design class, this should be interesting, okay. So I am teaching that class. We have a co-instructor, is a senior scientist in my group, Albano Souza, who will teach some of the lectures, especially some lectures that we're going to show you some software on how to handle certain problems, especially on bridges. Okay. I think some of you have seen Albano with some semester projects, he's very knowledgeable. And then also Diego Rosa, Heredia Rosa, who was a student here. He's a doctoral student now. And you will meet both on Thursday during the exercise time. Okay. Okay, so this class, so the grading components are primarily two. So essentially you have a midterm that is going to be in April 6th, and we will do it here in this class. And the material that will be covered will be the material that we will have till before the midterm. And this is a 2-hour exam, it's not a 3-hour exam, and you are allowed to have your notes open, because personally I don't, you are engineers, when we give you problems, you can open whatever you want, so your notes could be open, okay. There will be a final exam that covers the entire material course. We don't know the location yet, but you will know the location, and again, it's going to be open notes. Now, because that's a 4-credit, there is going to be, we are going to have 2 optional assignments that we will give you, one before the midterm and one after the midterm, that essentially will cover material that was taught in the class. And if you don't want to do the assignments, this is fine, but if you do the assignments, this will count a 10% bonus towards your total grade. So you can get a 20% bonus if you do both, or if you decide to do one of the two, again, you're getting so much. So basically you're getting 0.6 out of 6 for each one of them. So you can get 1.2 bonus if you decide to do both, and obviously you do it correctly. Okay. So these assignments are going to be assignments to help you understand more the class content, and also because we would like you to use some tools. These assignments will be assignments that will help you also to understand how you can use certain tools learn more, essentially what we are going to teach you. Okay, because sometimes when you do things just by hand, it's not obviously the same, or you learn up to a certain point versus, you know, this case. Do you have any question? We cannot change the midterm date, so yeah, because we have reserved the rooms, and it's going to be very tricky to change it. Okay. So make sure you mark this. Okay. And do you have any question about the exam or something? Okay. So the lecture notes will be distributed through Moodle like today. Sometimes we post some additional materials to Moodle, but I always inform you. And then the lecture notes, normally the lectures are recorded, and I post the the lecture on that link so you can watch it after.
Okay.
So normally I do this after Thursday, so I post the whole week all together.
Okay.
I think some, if you've taken any of my classes, I do the same for all the classes. So in case you are sick, or hopefully you're not going to be sick, or in case that something was not understood, you can always go back and check it.
Okay.
But make sure you come, because obviously, you know, it's not going to work very well if you don't come and we're like three people at the end.
Okay.
So that's it. Now, so what you are going to learn in this class is fundamentals of theory of stability, and also it will touch a bit on nonlinear behavior that some of you saw in the nonlinear class last semester. We will talk about imperfections and how these influence stability of structures, because when you design things and you sketch them, you always sketch straight lines, because that's what we taught you. Okay. The problem is when you order something for a structure to come on site, this never comes as a straight line, so basically it comes with imperfections. Okay. Some imperfections are allowable, even by code, but if the magnitude of imperfections is larger than expected, there are two options. You either call the fabricator and you tell the fabricator come and take everything back, but normally then you go to the court because they don't accept it, or you have to ensure that the imperfections you have are going to be still okay in terms of safety. Okay. But when you are dealing with imperfections, you have to handle this with some kind of stability theory, or like programs that you can use to evaluate the stability of a member or of a structure. And this is why this class could help you. Okay, now, so the class course is structural stability, so we are dealing with instabilities, so that we can see what's the ultimate capacity of members and systems. So this is why we are going to talk about column buckling. We are also going to talk about plate buckling, which is a common problem in bridges. In bridges, this is a common problem because if you've seen composite bridges, normally the girder or the beams are very tall. So when you have a very tall member, then it's very easy to make it essentially buckle. Okay. Another instability, mode that we see everywhere, but in bridges is more evident, is lateral torsional buckling. So again, we're going to put emphasis on those four a lot, and then we will talk about frames. And also you will see several examples that this, when you're not careful about these things, there are some very famous failures that happen every year because somebody was not paying attention to some of these items. Okay. Any question? So okay, I'll go through a small scan, and then I, like, you know what you're going to see, and then we will do this small review that the exercise on Thursday is more about this sort of easy statics. I mean, you all know statics, but we need to make sure that you can do calculations quickly, and this is not often the case. Okay. Okay, so the first one, I mean, okay, you've seen this. I mean, one reason why you want to take this class or classes like this, okay, is because we oftentimes design structures that are kind of unique, okay, and normally if you follow a design code is not going to cover cases that, you know, structures are becoming a bit special, okay. So in this case, to solve this type of problems that you are going to face, you will have to go back to some courses that you took because you have to use some tools that you have to understand how they work. Okay, so this class is gonna help you with the principles, and then if you use these kind of tools, hopefully you will be able to explain some of the results that you're going to use to design some of these structures. Okay, and we have several examples, like, you know, when the architects try to push things forward, you also have to push things forward when it comes to structural safety, or, like, you know, in bridges. In this case, if you've been to San Francisco or if you've visited the Bay Bridge, like, the cable of the Bay Bridge goes under the deck and then essentially returns, and this is not, we don't do this, okay, but because in San Francisco, the engineer said, you know, we want to build a bridge that everybody's going to talk about the engineering. They wanted to do this, and this, of course, boosts the cost to, I don't want to say numbers, but it was a lot more than expected, okay. Also, you've seen that because of the urbanization, but also because of other reasons, the heights of the structures become extremely tall. So you have to push the envelope on materials, but also when you make a structure very tall, you make it very flexible, and if a structure becomes flexible, then stability of the system becomes very important. Okay, this is why, for instance, a nuclear power plant cannot be that tall, because you want it to be extremely rigid. Okay. Because you don't want it to deflect a lot during a wind or during an earthquake event, okay? So in this case though, because you make the height extremely tall, you have problems with vibrations, and this could turn out to be a big problem, okay? So, yeah, I mean, yes, it's oftentimes this sort of is pushed by art, so that's architects, probably that's why they put us in this class. Okay, so you have to deal with things like this, and the design code doesn't cover this class, classes of structures. Okay. Now, as I mentioned, you have to, I mean, you saw this earlier, but oftentimes you have to analyze the behavior of component that is not trivial what it does, so you have to use software. And the problem with software is that the software asks for input. Okay, so some of the input you will be able to provide, but there are other questions that you will have to face when you are dealing with software. That if you are not sure what you are doing, you need to somehow evaluate your answer, because you cannot say, you know, I don't know what it does, and then I'm gonna use it to design something, because then you can easily end up in the court. Okay. So when you are using software, it will be helpful if you are able to benchmark your answer. And again, this class could help you with some analytical solutions that we can derive and so on, that you, if you model this solution to software, you will be able to understand if you're doing the right thing or not. Okay, so this is, so for instance, this here, or this here, it's not very clear, but this here is a plate buckling problem, right? So if you have a plate here, and the plate experiences compression, okay, the compressive stress will essentially create a plate buckling, as you saw here, okay. And if you are able to calculate the stress at which this happens, then obviously if you model this simplified member in the software, and you are able to reproduce the same stress, it means that you know how to use it. Okay, so what we are going to show you is how you can frame a problem like this mathematically, and how can you solve it. Okay, this problem is not very trivial, in the sense that if you have one plate, it's not very difficult, but if you have a cross section, it's not very easy, because the cross section has boundary effects, because you have a web here that restrains the plate. So again, we are going to show you how you handle this. Okay, Also, if you've taken, how many of you have done the bachelor's here? Okay, how many of you, I mean, if you haven't done the bachelor's here, it doesn't matter, but for sure you've taken a STEAL class, right? Okay, so in a STEAL class, if you've done it here, the very tall man has told you, or if you've done it elsewhere, the person who taught you has told you that there's this class one, class two, class three, class four cross sections, okay, and they've told you that you know, if I have a cross section here, okay, that if you have this sort of, we call this B, we call this T, you need the B over T to be less than something, okay, that is 9 epsilon, and epsilon is the square root of whatever, okay, so 235 over Fy, okay. So this limit comes from something like this. So somebody, because oftentimes, you know, you ask, I don't understand what this means. Okay, so this limit is a limit that essentially comes by solving this problem here. And you are trying to establish a limit here on the plate that depends on the geometry and the material you are using. So that this deformation is restrained. Okay. So if you are not happy with limit for class one sections and you would like to have more capacity, it means that you need to establish a new limit. But if you make it, say, 5 times epsilon, means you are being very strict. It means that you are making this member heavier. Okay, so if you are making it heavier, you are increasing the cost of construction. But sometimes, if you are dealing with a special construction, that, for instance, you may be interested about the performance under wind load, but this, the owner says, I would like that this thing is also very good for terrorist attack. Okay. So you're stuck because it means that you have to evaluate loads that are not covered well in the code, and it means that you have to maybe, you know, rethink about the limits, but you also don't want to make this 10 times more expensive. Okay, so this is why you need to use a little bit of theory to basically understand where can you go and how much capacity are you gaining when you're doing this. Okay. Bridges. I mean, are monumental structures that every country is interested primarily because of the need in mobility. So in bridges, there are several ways to do this, okay, but in particular, if you're dealing with a bridge that is a composite bridge, you probably have to use girders like the ones you see here. And you see that when you are looking at the girders, you normally have to provide this sort of restraints here. These are lateral restraints. Because if you don't do it, what could happen is this. Okay. So or even if you do it and you don't do it correctly, what could happen is this. So this is a project in Canada. I was still there at that time. So what happens here is that these members are very long, okay, but at the same time they are very tall. Okay. So the problem with tall girders, because you need high stiffness, right? So because when your car passes, you don't want to feel the deformation, okay? Because if you feel the deformation, you will say, you know, something's not right. So you need very tall members that are providing stiffness. But the problem with very tall members is, if they are I-shape, is that they can twist easily. Okay. So So this problem is known to us, okay, for a long time, okay, and it's basically called the lateral torsional buckling. Or if you've taken the class in some people call it just torsional buckling, but it's not exactly correct. Okay, so to stop this, you have to provide these lateral supports here, but lateral supports, so you need to say two things. The first one is you need to say at what distance you have to do it. Okay, so here, for instance, the distance is set is maybe, you know, every 1.5 meters. Okay, and obviously, you know, this worked because no problem happened during construction. Okay, now here, the second thing you need to say is how strong these things have to be, right? Because you see that, you know, if you provide these members, I mean, okay, maybe the distance is right, but if the member is very weak, so it doesn't have enough strength, what could happen is that when one tries to turn, maybe the truss you provide in between is going to experience instability, because what happens here is that somebody did not calculate properly the force that this member experiences and didn't put the right member. Okay, so again, to study this problem, you have to know how to handle this properly. So again, we are going to show you the theory of lateral torsional buckling, but also we are going to show you some tools that actually engineers use in practice. How to calculate the capacity of these things. And also, we are going to include not just mechanical loading, but these members have problems also under thermal gradient, because today, for instance, it's a semi-cold day, but in the summer, the temperature will rise to maybe 30 degrees. Okay, so this member will try to expand. So when you have expansion, you have, and you are not careful with the boundaries, you may have very large axial loads. So if you have large axial loads and you haven't considered, the problem will be that you will experience something like this. Okay, this is not the problem here. The problem here is that during construction, somebody made a mistake in the calculation of the bracing, and basically this happened when they woke up in the morning. So this was all over the news that day, okay. So, okay, now what else? So the other thing that we're going to discuss is, so far I was talking about member stability, okay. So ultimately what we care is about global stability, and because you may be okay with the member stability and you design everything correct, when you come to the structural level, you may have a global stability problem, because your primary enemy, let's say, is gravity. Okay. So if you have gravity wants to bring the structure always on the floor. Okay. And when the structure is not pushed laterally, then there's no problem if you design the members for stability. But if the wind load or the earthquake load tries to push structures laterally, then gravity is offset. Okay. And when you offset gravity, it creates additional forces that if you haven't considered, this is going to happen. Okay. This is a famous example that, we like to show, in the sense that, you know, this is a structure that was designed according to the code. Okay. It's very regular. You say, you know, this is the ideal case that the code can handle. So the structure was constructed on a big table here. So this is about 14 meters tall, about 10 meters long, 6 meters wide. So construct on a big table, the table can shake. Okay. So for those of you that are not familiar, this is the E-Defense safe table that you can shake real structures. This is 1,200 metric ton structure. Okay. So this, for instance, so this here is the structure. You see the table here. You can understand the scale of the other building because these are people. Okay, these are people. And here you see the structure from the from this side. Okay, here you see the first the column at the first story at the base, and then here you see the column at the same column at the top. So what happens? Oops.
Maybe I need to click. Okay. So what happens here is that the
structure was designed by cone, how come this happens? Okay, so there are two problems here. So you get a soft story. There are two problems here. The first one is that if you look carefully here, if you look carefully here, so I have a plate buckling problem that I discussed before. Okay, so maybe this limit was not maybe so safe originally. Okay, so it induces failure, and then when the limit when failure initiates by local instability, then while the building moves, gravity also takes over and creates what you see. Okay, so in this case, this is a combined problem. So we would like to avoid this one for like events like this, like the one we shook the structure, but also we would like to engineer the joint here, and we don't want failures in columns, we would like failures in beams. Okay. So if you come to the advanced steel design class tomorrow, when we design frames, we are going to show you how we do this. We call this capacity design because we would like certain modes. We would like certain members to fail before others. Okay, columns are not good to fail because you carry your enemy. Okay, and your enemy has to go on the floor safely. Okay, beams can fail, but in a controlled way, because we can replace the beams if they fail, but the columns are very hard to replace. So what we need to show you here is, okay, we are going to talk about the member, but the other thing is we would like to show you some additional things that you need to know when it comes to global stability, and in particular you have to check what additional forces the gravity creates under some deformation, and you have to make sure that these forces are limited. Okay, so we are going to see how we limit those. Okay, and next week we will also show you how you can derive a mechanism like this by using some principles of statics and material nonlinearity. We call this plastic mechanism analysis. Okay. So this type of analysis is very important because under the load combinations that you have, you need to make sure that the collapse load that your structure can carry is safely above the load you are expecting. Okay. Otherwise, you don't have a safety margin, and because loads, especially earthquake and wind, they are highly random. So if you design for a particular load, but you forget about this randomness, it means that you don't have any safety margin to provide to your structure. Okay. So this is a plate buckling problem. So here, obviously, this is perhaps right on the limit. And for this type of system, it has to become more severe. We also try to, we have a semester project that we kind of teach this, but in obviously with a more, with a structure that we can, you know, rebuild several times. So this is an electric shape table that we have. Maybe some of you, has anybody taken this? No. Okay, so this is an electric shape table. So this is the MOLA kit that essentially consists of some springs. So you see that, you know, it can capture these deformations, but when you have failure at the component level, which is detachment, or it's not fracture, but it's a detachment of the magnet, what happens is that the gravity, once the deformations are substantially large, gravity will basically create these forces that will bring your structure on the floor. Okay. So you can, what we do in this class is that we can describe this problem mathematically.
Okay.
So this is, say, displacement. This is the first derivative of displacement. It's going to be velocity. So this is called the phase diagram. You don't need to worry about it yet because we will talk about it in 2-3 weeks or so. So what we did here is that, you know, during we created some shaking because this is when the load that you would like to prevent failure comes. So what this load does, it tries to, your system rests at zero because at time zero, there's no velocity, there's no displacement, okay? So your the load comes in, right? It creates a, we call it perturbation, or like creates some kind of noise to your structure. So your structure starts moving, okay? Now if, you know, this will start moving, right? If this comes back to zero, then you can express this mathematically and you can solve it. If it comes back to zero, it means that everything's fine, okay? But if from here you end up, your vibration ends up like, you know, out here, it means that it's not gonna be fine because this vibration is not bounded. Okay, it doesn't have a maximum. So if it doesn't have a maximum, it means that the displacement always grows. So it means that eventually you will have instability. Okay, so this is, so if I go back here, right, and I'm monitoring the displacement at this node over time. Displacement over time, okay. So what happens is that at t equals zero, I am creating a vibration, and if the displacement starts fluctuating over time and eventually comes back to zero, it means that I had the system that I vibrated and, you know, it came back to zero, everything's fine, okay? Because I cannot design the system to be infinitely stiff because this is going to cost a lot of money. Okay, so I need to allow some deformation. Now, if you create a vibration that essentially it's never bounded, okay, like the one I showed you in the video, the problem is that in this case, displacement becomes infinite. So in this case, nothing stops it, and you will for sure have failure because no component can take extremely large deformations without experiencing failure. Okay. So this is called dynamic approach for checking stability, and you are going to see how it's been derived and how it's been solved for a system.
What else do I have? Okay, so the
other thing you're going to see is that in certain structures like this one, we see this in industrial buildings, for instance. Normally I do a break at 9 o'clock. We're still okay, right? Ah, okay, so I do a break at 9 o'clock, then for 15 minutes, then we basically go every 45 minutes. Okay. In this case, this is a little different situation in the sense that in industrial buildings or in actual buildings, we like using braces. Because if you have, say, an industrial building, maybe you have some equipment like cranes and things like this, that you don't want this equipment to displace a lot. Okay. during very strong wind or in the case of an earthquake series. Okay. So the problem is these elements here, when your structure deflects laterally, they will go in compression, and then under compression, if they are very slender, they will buckle. Okay. So in this case, yeah, so the compressive element here is going to buckle. The tensile element here, it has a stable mechanism, unless if you have a fracture.
Okay.
But the one in compression is really the one that could create instability.
Okay.
And then when the load changes, whatever this was doing, this has to do. So you need to provide this sort of load path that the structure can redistribute the loads and can safely transfer them on the ground.
Okay.
So a brace that goes in compression will reach a load here that is called the critical load, and then it's going to start losing load. So obviously you don't want this load here to be very, very close to zero, because if it's very, very close to zero, under wind that we were experiencing last week, these members will go.
Okay.
Then when it comes back to tension, it regains load, and it can actually reach N plastic RD or PY. So this is fine. Okay, this is fine. But the problem is when they go back to compression, again you have the same type of mechanism. Okay. So again, we would like to establish some sort of theory that we can design these members properly so that you will estimate safely when this happens. Plus, if you have a very tall member, how can you make sure that you provide lateral stability and you basically go to a higher buckling mode that will increase this peak critical to something much bigger? We are also dealing with arches. So arches are very special structures, but the problem is that if you're standing up there, obviously what an arch can do, it can deflect substantially. This is not going to deflect, but if you stand up there, you don't want this deflection to become infinite. Okay, this is a common problem in roofs for stadiums. Okay, that's an arch typically. Okay, so you can describe this problem mathematically like this, in the sense that, you know, you can create a simple mathematical model that you've learned in statics. So the primary load that is acting in this case could be gravity or wind, will try to push the system down, and if you are creating a very large span, okay, the problem is the angle here you are creating. So you would like to know what would be peak critical in this case, because you would like to make this as light as possible. Okay. So if you've been to a stadium that has a truss arch, normally we don't want these members to be very heavy because they cost a lot. But at the same time, we don't want them to be very light because this deflection could be substantial. Okay. So you can again express equilibrium, you can solve this equation and so on. You can find the angle at which you're going to be losing stability, and eventually you can calculate, you can get it to forces, and you can also take into account what material linearity will do in this case. Here you can create what we call the equilibrium path that is going to tell you, for the given conditions that you have, at what point you're going to lose stability. So if you know the material you are using and you are approaching this load here, you can basically design your member appropriately so that you can prevent or increase peak critical to something that makes you happy. Okay. So that's more or less what you're going to see in this class. But you know, I tried to give you a bit of a snapshot of everything. And we will stop now for like 15 minutes, then we start with this, which is
review of your statics, but in the way that I like to do it. Okay, this way, it's not, this is a way that, you know, if you are in a design site, you're gonna be able to do calculations extremely quickly. And these calculations will be 10% off, sometimes 100% correct, but sometimes 10% off from using a software. Okay, so this is very important because you can do things quickly. And it will help you also see some things that you haven't realized that are happening in structures. Okay, so more in 15 minutes. Okay.
So, I think maybe some of you, have seen this before, but or you will also see it tomorrow if you're interested in advanced design. But so in a conventional statics class, people have taught you the principle of virtual work. Okay, I'm not going to ask you to do the principle of virtual work for what I want to do, but I just want to show you that. If you've done this, what I'm going to talk about is very natural if you just observe it one more time here. Okay, so let me explain. So suppose you have the only thing I'd like you to remember is going to be what is the deflection of a cantilever element. And that you know the material, and you know the moment of inertia, and you know the area, and you are trying to understand what will be the deflection under lateral load F. Okay, so the only thing I will ask you to remember will be the deflection for this case. Then I claim that any other structure that I'm going to handle will always be a combination of this. Okay, so let me explain a couple of things. So the first one is that if I'm dealing with this, you know that I have, so if I'm dealing with a cantilever, right? I know that the moment of the cantilever will be F times L, and I also know that the shear of the cantilever will be just the force F, that you know, okay. So if you apply the principle of virtual work to compute the deflection, so the principle of virtual work tells you that the deflection is a combination of three components. The first component comes from flexure. So if I have flexure, I will have delta 1 that comes from flexure. Okay, that will be given by the moment from the real load times the moment from the unit load that I put at the tip. And it's going to create the same moment diagram, but here I'm going to have 1 times L, right? EI, and then you do over EI, and then you do the integration from 0 to L, because the member has a length equal to L. And then the principle of virtual work tells you that the total deflection will have a second component that will basically be equal to the contribution of shear. And if you have axial load, in this case we don't have axial load, you will also have a third deflection that comes from the axial load. And note that in flexure we basically divide with EI, okay, with, in shear we divide with GA, in axial load we divide with E times A. Okay, so this is the virtual, so the hat is the virtual load. And also these diagrams come from by applying a unit load at the point I'm interested to compute the deflection. Okay, so here I'm interested to compute the deflection here, and I'm putting a unit load here. Okay. So if I so that's basically the hard part. Okay, so I'm putting 1 times L, and the shear becomes 1. So this is going to be 0 because there is no axial load. Okay, so if you do these calculations and you've done it. Okay, and when you did statics, and perhaps a bit more than regular statics, So if you do here the substitutions, okay, and you solve the integrals, so here I have a moment diagram that is basically linear, moment diagram linear. I'm putting these terms here. Here I have a CR that is constant, so I'm putting the CR here. This doesn't exist, so then I do the integration. These are like polynomials, so I can do the integration. So if you do the integration, there are two things that you see at the end. So that's what I want you to remember, okay? So you see that the deflection is f times L to the power of cube divided by 3EI. Okay, so this is the flexibility, okay, of a cantilever because of flexure. Okay, and you also see that the deflection here depends on the CR, okay, but if you are dealing with frame elements, so a frame element is this. So this is a frame element here. And the beam here running is a frame element. Okay. So if you are dealing with frame elements, not walls. Okay. Then when you are computing deflections, if you neglect this part, you are basically 99% close to the answer. Okay. So what I would like you to remember, so for frame elements or frame structures, so these are a lot of structures, okay. I would like you to remember that for a cantilever case, the deflection is simply force divided by stiffness, and the stiffness is 3i over L cubed. Okay, or force times flexibility, okay. And the flexibility is L cubed divided by 3i. Okay, so what I'd like you to remember, is you know that, you know, the force is equal to stiffness times deflection, okay? So basically what I saw, this is the Hooke's law. So the Hooke's law says that for a member subjected laterally to load F, deflection will be this, and basically this is F divided by 3EI over L2. So that's approximately. Okay. So that's what I want you to remember, okay? So that you have done, but maybe you know you have, maybe you don't remember it yet. Okay. This term here is important. If you have a shear wall, if you have a wall, then this term will become significant because the area of the wall is very substantial. Okay. So then this deformation here, if you neglect it, maybe you will be doing 30% error. Approximately 30% error, okay. So for now, you remember this, okay. So let's see now what I can do with this, okay. Contribution to flexion, contribution to shear. Okay, so let's see what I can do with this. So if I ignore, as I said, the CR, then, you know, it comes down to this one. This is, if you want to be very 100% correct, this should be approximate. But again, for frame structures, if you really do this with the software, you will see that you will be 99% close. You will be losing the answer on the second decimal. Okay, because CR deformations are not very substantial. Okay, now, so that's basically what I just said here. So that's what I want you to remember. If you remember that, things will be really good. Okay, so let's see. So let me explain why I say, you know, these things are going to be really good. So say, you know, now I'm dealing with a fixed member that experiences lateral load F. How many cantilevers do you see? Okay, can you explain? So he says two, so this deflects laterally, right? So what happens here is that the moment diagram in this case is going to be a triangular moment diagram, right? So I have we call it moment point that the moment becomes zero, or we have an inflection point, we call it inflection point also, or the point that the moment becomes zero. So if you want to solve this problem, okay, what you can do is that you can see this as one cantilever element, like the ones you saw before, from the base to the inflection point. So that's one cantilever, and then you have a second cantilever that is from the point that you have moment zero all the way up, like flipped. Okay. So the only difference from what I saw before, so if I want delta, I can calculate delta one, and then I can calculate delta two from this point to the inverted cantilever part. So that's delta two. So the only difference here compared to the previous example is that the length is not L for each one of the cantilevers, but it's L over 2. Okay, so if I want the total deflection, it's going to be delta 1 plus delta 2, because I'm just summing up cantilevers. Okay, and delta 1 will be F over K1, delta 2 F over K2, and K1 is 3i over L over 2 to the power of cube, plus the same thing. So the total deflection of this is F divided by 12i over L cube, or F times L cube over 12i. Okay. So if you want the, so then I calculate deflection. Okay. Now, if you want the moment diagram, it's very easy, because the moment diagram of this thing, okay, it's gonna be like cantilever moment diagram from below, and you have the anti-symmetric from above. And here, F will come here, because the length is L over 2, the moment down here is L over 2. Okay, and CR is the first derivative of moment. So if you have a linear moment diagram, the CR has to be constant, and it has to be equal with F. So that's it. Okay. Now, so if you just with that, you can solve a lot of structures that you haven't realized without having to do conventional statics, because I will explain why. Like, for instance, let's talk about this case. Okay, let's talk about this case. So this case is a case of a frame, okay, that the beam is has very large stiffness and is basically rigid. Okay. So if I look at, for instance, this room that we are, right, if I look at the column versus the beam, finally, you know, it's happening. You know, I was looking for a cluster. So if you look at the beam here, the because the height of the beam is very, very, it's about maybe a meter or so, maybe a little less than a meter. If you calculate the moment of inertia here versus the column, this moment of inertia, obviously, you know, it's not infinite, but it's like, because infinity doesn't exist in structures, okay, but it's extremely large compared to the corresponding moment of inertia of the columns. So here, if you assume that the, if somebody tells you, you know, there is strong wind outside, and, you know, calculate the lateral deflection, you say, okay, how many frames? 10. Okay. The beam is rigid. I have two columns. Here I have four columns. So this is identical. This is identical with four times the previous case. Okay, so this is identical with four times of this. So each one of them will deflect like this. Delta here is gonna be the same.
So delta here is going to be the same delta here, here, and here. So it's going to be the total stiffness of this is going to be four times the stiffness of one. Okay. So you know that the single stiffness is 12 VI over L cube.
We just proved it.
Okay, you don't need to remember it by heart because you just need to remember one cantilever. Okay. And if you want to draw the moment diagram here, it's going to be four times the moment diagram that you saw before. That's it. Okay. Now, if you have a bridge, okay, imagine that's a bridge. There's a valley, right? There's a valley, and there is pier 1, pier 2, and you have a very long pier in the middle. Okay, that's a bridge. That's how we do bridges, okay. So you subject this laterally with F. Again, the bridge has a very, you saw the girders, right? They are very stiff because we don't want, so this is good because the bridge has very stiff girders, I can only calculate the lateral deformation with what the piers will do. But these are look like cantilevers, like almost cantilevers. Like for instance, this one, it's going to have a stiffness of 12 EI1 over L1 to the power of cube. This, it's going to be the same, but I3, because you may have a different pier geometry, right? It's going to have 12 EI3 divided by L1 to the power of cube. And then the middle, that is the most flexible, will have 12 EI2 divided by L2 to the power of 3. Okay. So if you need the total stiffness, I'm going to add the 3. So I have the total stiffness of the system. So if I need the deflection will be F divided by K. No software. But if you use a software and you do the calculation, it's gonna be literally, you're gonna be losing it in the second decimal. Because this is a textbook case. Meaning, you have very slender elements. The CR is not very substantial because you don't have a lot of area here to get this, get CR deformation. You don't have a lot of area here. If this was coming out here, that's a different story. But you will see how we do this also. And you say, okay, deflection is good, but what about the moment diagram? The moment diagram is going to be, if I know the CR, I can calculate the moment diagram, because in all these cases, I know that the moment diagram is going to look like this. So if I have lateral load of a fixed element, I know that the moment diagram is always like this. Okay, but you don't know the value. But if you know F, you know that this is F times L over 2. So the question is, how do you find F for the individual piers? Okay, so it's simple because it's simple in the sense that the load likes to go to the stiffer. So if I'm looking at this room, I look at the column here, I look at the column there. If I had lateral load, because these are equal, the load will be split equally to the two. If this one was three times bigger, the load likes to go to the stiffer first, meaning what happens here is that the F is going to be split to V1, V2, V3. So that's fine. And then V1 plus V2 plus V3, that's what Professor Bayer taught you in year one, or like whenever you did statics. Like if you have V1 plus V2 plus V3, that's equal to F. Okay. Now, because the load likes to go to stiffer, the F will be distributed according to the relative stiffness of the individual element. So the first one will take K1 over K total. The second one will take K2 over K total. And the third one will take the rest. Okay, there's no assumption here. It's 100% correct. So if somebody, this is, sometimes if you are doing interviews for an office,
the engineer likes to ask you, you know, I have a wall, I have a column like this, and I put 100 kilonewton. Where does the load go?
And the load will say it goes to the column, so you are out automatically.
So the load likes to go to the stiffer first, and then once this is over, meaning, you know, it's damaged and all that, so it softens, it shifts to the next stiffer element. That's what the load does. Okay. Now, if you've been to IKEA and you are looking at this parking garage that you park your car, right? You know, this is this 2 times or 3 times, I forget. So this is this case 3 times. Okay. So already we can do a lot of stuff, okay, meaning by hand. There are cases though that are not here, and let's see what are these cases. Ah, yeah, okay, so this is pretty much, I elaborate more on that. So here the inflection point is here, here, and here. So if I know the shear, I can draw the moment diagram. Because the moment diagram will simply be V1 times L over 2 for the individual ones, or individual elements, okay? Now, so again, so far with what you saw, it's error-free, like no error. And the only error you are doing is that the shear deformation is basically zero. You assume that the shear deformation is zero, but there is a lot of software out there that you have been using, or maybe you have used, that they are already doing this assumption without telling you. Okay. Meaning, when you see the deflection plotted from the software, and the deflection says, you know, 3 millimeters, there is software out there that is assuming, that is doing the same assumption I did, and you just don't know. Okay, the problem, so if the software is dealing with frames, this assumption is okay, but if you are using the software to calculate deflections of walls, this assumption is not going to be okay, and you're going to have a big problem, because you will underestimate the deflections by at least 20 to 30% like this. So this is why this sort of back of the envelope, or like calculations that are very quick but very practical, can save you, because you can evaluate the solution of software, but also you can do quick things and very correct in this case for structures that you never thought you can perhaps do, but just by hand. Okay, like this one, you say, you know, I look at bridges around, and yeah, this could be a case. Okay, now the second case, so now I'm gonna make it a little more complex, okay, because it cannot just be like this. Otherwise, these companies that, you know, are doing software, they wouldn't survive. So, in this case, so I'm dealing now with a frame, not just an individual element. But in this case, what happens is that the beam element that I have, okay, so I have here 2 columns and I have a beam element. So the beam element I have does not have infinite rigidity. So if you want to picture this, it's like, you know, in this class here, this beam that you see does not have a very large moment of inertia. Perhaps it's maybe the same cross section of what we see over there. Okay, so if I make this half, then I is not substantially larger than the I of the column. And in this case, if you push this laterally, what you are going to see is that you are going to see that the beam also deflects in double curvature. Okay. So if you want to calculate delta now, you have 2 sources of components that contribute to deflection. Okay. The first source will be the columns, as was happening before. Okay. The second source that creates deflection is the deflection of the beam. Okay. How many cantilevers? You see? How many? I heard it. How many?
Six.
Yeah. So, you know, it's, so So you know, this deflects laterally, right? So you have one element, second element, so these are four, because you have one cantilever here, you have a second cantilever here, and then you have another one on this side, and then, you know, if you look at the beam here, this needs some imagination in the sense that, you know, you basically have one cantilever here, and this is basically the ideal position that this deflects, and you have this anti-symmetric on this case. So, but let's see now how we can use this cantilever approach to compute deflections. Okay. So when this deflects laterally by delta, okay, because this is a fixed boundary, and here I don't have a fixed boundary, I have some stiffness, but it's not zero. Okay. I'm going to have a moment zero somewhere here. I'm going to have moment zero at the middle of the beam. Okay. So here, in order to solve this problem, I have to make an assumption that now I will introduce some error to this sort of approach I'm showing you, but this error is very small. Okay, so what is this assumption? In order to be able to solve this problem, I'm going to have to assume where is the point that the moment I assume it becomes zero. Okay. So in a fixed case, I know that this is always at h over 2 or l over 2. In this case, it's not going to be here, but it's going to be a bit higher because the moment here is going to be larger than the moment up there, because up there it's not a fixed boundary. Okay. But because I don't know the exact position, the assumption I will make to still be able to do things by hand will be that the moment of inflection will be pretty much zero at the middle height of the column. Okay. So this will introduce some error, but this error is not more than 10-15% if you calculate the total deflection. Okay. Of course, it may depend on the case you are dealing with. Maybe, you know, it may be a little less or a little more, but it will be around that much. So that's the assumption I need to do. Okay, so now if I want to calculate deflection first, I'm going to see this problem as the superposition of two. Okay, so the first, so I'm going to do the following. I'm going to say the total deflection will come from deflection of the columns plus deflection of the beam. So let's calculate deflection of the column first. Okay, so deflection of the column will basically be, if I assume a rigid beam for now, just to get the deflection of the columns, and this is back to the same problem I had, this is going back to the same problem I had before, where I have one fixed column, second fixed column. So if I want to calculate deflection of the column only, which is part of the total deflection, this is simply going to be F divided by 2 K columns, and each column is 12 EI over L cube. Okay. So that's the first portion I'm interested in. Okay. Now let's see the second. Okay. So the second is, of course, I don't have a rigid beam. The second is, how can I calculate delta here that comes from deflection of the beam only? Okay, so now what I need to do is that I need to assume that the columns are rigid before I assume that the beam is rigid, and I calculate the deflections coming from the column. Now I'm going to assume that the beam is not rigid and the columns are. I will see how this deflection can look like. Okay, and then I will try to estimate this delta here. Okay, now to do this, so here I'm gonna have to assume that the column is rigid, okay? Because I say that moment is zero here and moment is zero here. When the force F pushes laterally, everything is going to deflect, but everything is going to rotate with respect to the point that the moment is zero, because this is like a hinge, right? This is like a hinge. So if this is like a hinge, right? So for instance, this thing here, right, my laptop,
So it has a hinge here, right? So moment is zero. So if I push laterally, then even if this part is rigid, it doesn't really matter because the deflection concentrates only with respect to the point that I have zero moment. Okay. So if this is the column, right, and you know I can flip this vertically, right? If you push load here, with load here, because you have a hinge here, because moment is zero, this at the bottom is not gonna deflect because everything will rotate with respect to the pin, to the hinge. So this is the same exact situation here. So if you want to calculate the deflection of the beam up here, okay, you have to deflect your structure with rigid columns by locating these hinges in the right position. And in order to calculate this delta here, the way I'm gonna do it is by basically using these two cantilevers that you see. Okay, so let's see how this is done. So delta here, do you agree that delta here is theta times L over 2?
You must agree.
So, okay. So delta here, up here, okay, is theta times h over 2. Okay, h over 2, because I'm basically cutting the bottom part, but it doesn't really matter. Okay. So delta beam up here that I'm interested is theta times h over 2. So you say, okay, but now you have theta as an unknown. Fine. So theta here is equal with the theta here, because from geometry, I mean, these angles are equal. Okay. Now, because theta here is also equal with theta here, because these angles are angles with perpendicular sides. Okay. It means that if I calculate theta up there, that essentially comes from deflection due to bending or flexure of the beam, I will be able to solve the problem. Okay, so do you agree that theta up there is equal with the moment that the beam experiences divided by the stiffness that the beam has, meaning rotational stiffness? Okay, so you say, okay, so now I have from one unknown, I have two. Yes and no, because these are not exactly unknowns, because now we can use the cantilevers, okay, and we can find the moment, we can find the stiffness. Let's see how. So let's look at this stiffness first. I will tell you about the moment after. Okay. So I claim that the stiffness here is equal to. The stiffness of the beam up there is equal to 3 EI beam times I beam divided by L beam divided by 2. So you say, you know, this looks familiar, but something is missing, like this to the power of 3. Okay, so let's see why this is happening. So let me explain a little bit, a couple of things. Let's see how we can do this. Okay, let me write. Okay. Okay, so let me explain a little bit here the situation. Okay, so before, in this case, sorry about that. So if that's F and that's delta, and let's call this theta, okay. Before, we said that for this case, F is equal to K times delta, and we said that F is equal to 3 EI over L cube.
times delta. That's what we said before. Right? Now, here, do you agree, so this is L, so do you agree that theta is equal to delta over L? You agree, okay. Also, if you want to calculate the moment here, that, or depends how you want to draw it, let's draw it like this. So if you want to calculate the moment here that creates this theta or this delta, the moment here is equal to F times L. Okay. So if I take this one and I basically do this, so F is equal to 3EI times L delta over L. So basically what I did is I took the L cube and I said L times L times L. Okay, so what I do now is I take delta over one of the L's, so because I'd like that, and I will send one L here because I would like moment. Okay, so I'm gonna send this here. So F times L is equal to 3EI over L times theta. Okay, so M is equal to 3EI over L times theta. Okay, so if you want to link force displacement, the stiffness that you need is basically 3I over L cube. If you want to link moment rotation, the rotational stiffness will be 3I over L. Okay, so what I all I did is I rewrote this in a way that's convenient for me, because the variables of the problem are not F delta, but they are moment rotation. Okay. And what I did is I rewrote L cube in a way that basically I get what I want from a rotation, because I'm interested about the rotational stiffness. So if I, can I take this down, or can I take this down? Okay. So if I go back here now, after this, if I go back here now, okay. So what happens here is that I'm interested about this stiffness, and I want to get it out of the way and introduce some terms that I can use for computation. So if I look there, This is the rotational stiffness, because it links theta, m, and k. That's the rotational stiffness of this cantilever. Okay, of this cantilever. Okay, so it's like, you know, something deflects it here. Okay. So all I need to do is I need to read 3i over L star. Okay, and L star here is LB divided by 2. Is it clear? Okay, so what I'm doing here is that this is now the cantilever that deflects here. So the dashed line, imagine that, you know, I have a cantilever flipped, rotated by some angle, right? And this red one here deflects with respect to this dashed line. So what happens here is that the length I'm interested is not LB, but LB over 2. Okay. And like this, I can express the stiffness with everything I know. So if I rewrite this a little bit, I get MB times LB divided by 6 EIB times H over 2. So you say, fine, but what about the moment? So the moment, it's actually very easy to find. Why? Because the moment up here that creates this angle is equal with the moment here, because at the corner, this element and this element must have the same moments. Okay. So the moment is simply equal to F over 2 times the height. Okay. So if you want to express the moment here, the moment, if I come on this side, right? Is, so I have F that goes to F over 2, F over 2. Why is that? Because
both columns are exactly the same, have exactly the same properties. Okay, so this means that the lateral force is going to be split to two equal forces. Okay, so F over two. Now the height here is h over two. So the moment is simply F times h divided by four. Okay, so if I get this in here, I can get the deflection of a frame now, or a frame, just by hand, no software. And all you need to remember is this. Is this. Okay, and this little trick that I did, but I mean, this trick is just a matter of like going from this deflection to rotation, that they are not, they are linearly dependent. Okay. So we calculate deflection. It means that if you have a frame and you are able to calculate deflections, basically you know everything, because the deflection is really the primary problem of everything, in the sense that, you know, if a structure that does not deflect doesn't have problems, because no deflection means no additional moment. Like here, you know, nothing deflects right now. It means that, you know, we don't feel any danger or something. There are no additional moments on the columns beyond the gravity load that we, that the structure experiences right now, and the live load that it adds on the furniture. Okay, so now if you want the total deflection, that will be whatever comes from the columns plus whatever comes from the beams. And okay, you can rewrite this in a way that you can basically solve if you are dealing with a frame and you would like to control the amount of deflection. Like say that, you know, I calculate deflection and I'm not happy with what I see because there is this serviceability check that I need to do and make sure that the lateral deflection is not sufficient. What is more efficient, to increase the cross section of the beam or to increase the cross section of the column? You think? Well, the answer is it depends, because we see that the total deflection depends on both. Okay, but in a conventional frame, like think about, like normally we use frames for one reason. We would like to have a very big opening. So it means that in one dimension, not the height, in the other dimension, we would like a very long length. Okay, why is that? Because in typical buildings, the heights are set. They are like about 3.5 meters, 4 meters, around this. Okay, but this direction, that's about 10 meters, perhaps a bit less, that's about 8 meters, roughly 8 meters. Okay, in this direction though, that you have the longest dimension, what happens here is that you can control the deflection here more efficiently if you change the moment of inertia of your beams, because the beam deflects over L, and because L of the beam normally is 2 to 3 times bigger than the one in the columns, you are going to be more efficient if you just play with the moment of inertia of your beams. Okay. So like this, with a little formula like this, if you want to estimate, because you know, you can, if you have a very big structure and you would like to play a bit with the structure so that you can understand how you can eliminate deflections that you don't want. I mean, okay, there are a few ways to do this. Like, you know, you could use the software again and you could start changing beams. But I mean, how are you going to change them? Are you going to bring them 3 sections down? Are you going to bring them 1 section down? Or if you change your, if you come to the advanced steel design tomorrow, you will see that when we change beams, I'm advertising, you know, if you change the beam, it's not just that, because if you're dealing with seismic design, you have to do things to the columns as well. Okay, this also goes to reinforced concrete. Okay, so, but if you are just interested about controlling deflection and no other consideration, if I have a frame and I'd like to know how can I do this properly, the most efficient way is if I play with the beams. Okay. And
Yeah, I mean, you could sort of see it here that although these terms are a kind of inverse proportional with this, because this is typically much longer than my conventional column elements, normally it's more effective to do that. And that's the last slide for today before I basically talk about the CR aspect. So here, if you want the Bowman diagram, in addition to deflection, again, somebody said six cantilevers. It's true. Like, I have the two, the four obvious ones coming from the columns. So I have F over 2, the moment here, F8 divided by 4, the same up there because I made that assumption. Okay, that the inflection point is here, but in reality it's slightly higher. The moment up there has to be equal to the moment of the beam. Okay, and because the beam deflects like double cantilevers, essentially the moment diagram will be again anti-symmetric. Okay. So that's it. So if you have a second story, believe it or not, it's going to be exactly, you know, copy and paste. But you put a second story on top and you have to calculate the additional deflections in exactly the same way as we did now. If you have 20 stories, this is how we do it. Okay, so so that's it. Now, what I'd like to tell you about on Thursday is what we have if we have walls. Okay, so for walls, you cannot ignore the shear. Okay, but everything else is the same. In fact, walls are very easy because it's normally a single cantilever. And the last thing I'd like to tell you on Thursday is what do you do if you have braces? Okay, so braces are like a frame and a diagonal element that we have to see how we can get deflections. So, and then that's it for the first week. And the first exercise is related to this kind of things. So in the first exercise, we will show you an industrial building single story with a truss. And we will ask you to do these kind of things. Okay. Okay, I'll see you on Thursday. Okay, so good afternoon.
Welcome to the second.
So the, in the first, in the introduction, we said that we are going to do a little bit of revision of your statics. Some of you are still design, but this is only overlapping this week. Okay. Then the class is defined. Okay. So we in the previous class, we covered the we said, you know. We said that if you want to calculate deflections, because deflections are very critical, you can solve everything by thinking that the structure can be broken into cantilevers, and all you need to remember is what's the stiffness, lateral and rotational stiffness, or lateral stiffness, for one cantilever. Okay, and then we started doing some examples. We said that this is a cantilever, this is like cantilever up to here, cantilever up to here. So if you want the total deflection, you can sum up the two. And then if you want the bending diagram for a cantilever, looks like this. For an inverted cantilever, you flip it. And we also said that the shear is going to be constant because the shear is the first derivative of the moment. You know this. So if you know that the moment is linear, the shear has to be constant. Okay. Then we said that, you know, if you know this and you try to think other structures, you can really solve many with this principle. and also the other important thing here that we did was that besides calculating deflection, we also said that the load likes to go to the stiffer element because the load always is distributed proportionally to stiffnesses.
if you haven't realized this yet. Okay. So if between the three elements this is the stiffer, then the V1 is going to take the bigger percentage of F, because the K1 will be the largest portion of K total. Okay. And that principle always works in nature. If you are loading something, whatever is stiffer is going to take it. Okay. First. Then we talked about the moment diagram of that, if you know the inflection points. And then the other thing we did is that we covered the case that now the beam on top is not rigid. And this is a case that we typically see in frames. And because we design frames, of course, the beams, we don't design them to be infinitely rigid always, unless if we want to minimize vibration. And here, we decompose the problem to the beam column deformation. So then this is basically back to what we did before, plus the bending deformation of the beam. And the important thing here that we said is that when you put this under lateral load, you have to be careful with respect to the point that you are rotating this, because this point is really the point that the moment is zero. Okay. And if you were in this other class, we said there that suppose that, you know, I'm dealing with this example. And say the beam is not rigid, the connection is rigid. If I want to calculate the deflection of the beam, in this case, the moment is equal here, 0 to 0 here. If I look at this case, the moment will be close to 0 approximately here. Okay, so if I want to apply this analogy, then this will rotate with respect to this point, it will come here. Then this one will rotate with respect to this point, so it will come here, the same delta. And then the beam will deflect in double curvature. Okay. So if you have a physical boundary that the moment is zero, okay, here this is not a physical boundary, but it's been created because the statics make the moment zero at this point. Then if you want to calculate the deflection of the beam here, so you are interested about this theta, and you are interested about this theta, which is the same with this theta, okay. The point to rotate will be the physical boundary. Okay. And then we talked about the particular calculations. We're not going to redo it. And here we also said that if you are interested in controlling deflections in frames, because this dimension is typically much bigger than the height. You can see this here also, okay. Then this term is going to be more effective to change something, meaning, because the only thing you can change, if the architect tells you that this dimension has to be 10 meters, you cannot touch this. But the architect is not gonna tell you what is the beam that you need to put there to control the deflection. So this is your job. So if you say that in order to reduce the deflection, I'm going to touch the columns, this is possible, but because the columns are always kind of a fixed dimension, 3.5 meters, you will have to change a lot of them to really reduce the deflection. Whereas if you play with a beam, you will do maybe, you know, few beams, that's it. Okay, because normally the beams are approximately half of the columns. So if you increase the weight of the beams a little bit to control, so basically you increase stiffness to control deflection, that's more effective than playing with columns. But sometimes there are some constraints here. So if you change this one, you may have to do something also on the columns, because there may be some checks that by design you have to satisfy, and if you increase the beam, it may be that you have to do something else for the columns. Okay, so it could be a combination of the two, but intuitively the beams normally are more effective in frames computing deflections. Okay, and this is more or less where we stopped. Okay, now the next thing you, again, the next thing you need to, so if you are dealing with stability, the other type of structure you may have to face you may have to design within a structure for sure will be a wall. Okay. Here, for instance, we have walls where the stairs are. Okay. Or if you have an elevator, there has to be a wall. Okay. Now, in walls, the walls are not very difficult to handle because, by definition, these are cantilever structures. But the problem with walls is that you cannot just consider the flexural deformation in your calculations. You have to also consider the shear deformation. Okay. So the shear deformation is calculated. So when I do this, and I said, you know, 0 to L m bar EI dx. So the shear deformation will come from this integral. So this now is not negligible anymore, because the area of the wall here is becoming substantial. Okay. Now the problem is that unlike the flexure problem, the shear contribution here is giving you this sort of terms that depend on the shape of the wall. Okay, so if here in the integral I change the shape of the wall, it means that this becomes a variable. So you have to take that variable into account to calculate the integral. And for instance, for a rectangular wall, that is very common. If you want to calculate shear deformations and do calculation by hand, this shape factor will be approximately 1.2. Not approximately, will be 1.2. Okay. But if you actually do this, in this case, you can also consider the contribution of shear deformations to the total deflection. And in this case, normally this is at least 20% of the total. This for walls is about 20% of the total, so it can't. You cannot neglect this much. Okay, you cannot afford neglecting this much. Now, if you have concrete complicates the story, because the modulus you need to calculate here, the deflections as well as the shear modulus, depend on the compressive strength of the concrete. And I mean, this is an expression, but if you use SIA or other codes, this expression may be a bit different, but all of them at the end, they are more or less similar. Okay. And the reason why I'm putting this here is because normally walls are made of concrete or infill, okay, or masonry. Okay. So they are, these properties are not very pure like steel materials, that in steel, you know, it's 200 gigapascals and that's it. Because these materials have a cementitious nature, the modulus is a moving target, like, you know, it keeps changing. Okay. Because it really depends on the compressive strength of concrete. Okay. Now, if you ask the compressive strength of concrete, this is highly variable because it also depends on time. Okay. So be careful with this on concrete. Okay. Now but other than that, normally these structures are pretty trivial, because if I sketch it here, suppose that I have a three-story wall structure. So say that this is my wall, and it's gonna be fixed. Okay. And here I have the floor system. Normally the way this works is that this is so it could be a pin connection again.
So here, I mean, this is like a room like this one.
Okay.
Room like this one. And you know, if you look at these, if you look at these trusses, the way they are connected with the wall, you cannot see it because this is not a wall. This is a partition. But there is a wall. If we open the door, there is a wall where the stairs are. Yeah. The staircase is okay. So this connection cannot take transfer moment, because if this connection can transfer moment, then it would look much bigger. Okay. If we open it, this connection here cannot transfer moment. Okay. So the reason why we like it like this is because these connections are very easy to assemble. In fact, I can assemble this on the floor, and with a crane I can put the whole thing in place, and then I bolt left and right. Okay. Now this structure, believe it or not, if you are interested about deflection, this is like a cantilever, because this, if that's moment zero, I mean, you just need to calculate the deflection of this thing, and then everything else follows. It's a mechanism, right? So everything else follows. So this one is gonna come here. I mean, this is gonna rotate like this. This is gonna come here. Yeah, and this is gonna become somewhere here. Okay. So in this case, the wall really is the primary element, and we like this type of construction because the wall is very stiff and it can take the lateral load. It's very easy to fabricate the wall because it doesn't matter if you are in Switzerland or if you are in the US or if you are in any place of the world, everybody knows how to build a concrete wall. Okay. Then the floor system, it's very easy to construct because you are not asking for, you're just asking for bolted connections. Okay. Most of the countries in the world can do bolted connections. The problem starts when you start asking welded connections, because not everybody can weld the same way. So this is a very good type of construction, and also the way to analyze it is very trivial, if you haven't realized yet. Okay. Now the last type of system that you are going to, or you have already seen, but maybe you haven't realized what it does, is the braces or frames with bracing. Again, the way that you should envision braces is similar to a wall, but meaning, you know, stiffness wise. When you have braces, you are really trying to make something very stiff. Okay. And perhaps is a bit more efficient than the wall in the sense that you are using much less material. Okay. But the problem there is that in these diagonals you are creating, one will experience compression, the other experiences tension. Okay. So we did this, you know what I'm looking for. This one, okay. So the, okay, before. Okay. So frame structures, if I want to make things cheap, what I have to do is that I need to make sure that the connections are not moment connections. So basically, if I build the frame like this, the connections are not moment connections, so it means that I can really build them with very trivial ways. For some of you that they don't understand how this can be done, so this can be done as follows. Suppose you have a column. Okay, suppose you have a column and you would like to build this as a shear connection. So what you need to do is that you need to put a plate. You need to put a plate. The easiest way to do this is you make a hole here and then you put a beam. Okay, you put a beam. and you make a hole also on the beam, and then you put a pin here. So that's a pin connection. Okay. This connection is the cheapest you can make on site. Okay. You just need to do a fillet weld here, by the way. So this has to be a fillet. Okay. Put this. Okay. So this connection is the cheapest one to make, but if you think about it, if this is your house, you are really relying on one bolt. And if this bolt is the one that the factory had that problem, that, you know, that day was creating, you know, this thing with cars, that, you know, you buy a car and after 2 years they call you, they say you need to bring the car because we realized that 2 years ago that we were fabricating these cars, one door has a defect, so we need to change your door. So if this is the bolt that needs to be changed after 2 years, but nobody's gonna tell you that, because normally the companies that make bolts are not gonna call you, okay? Then you are really relying on one bolt, so this connection is not a very safe connection, so this is why oftentimes we say we're not gonna use one, we're gonna use a few more. So this connection is a pin connection, okay? So these connections are very cheap to make, and you can use them in frames like this. The problem is when you use these connections and you have a lateral load, you know that this is a mechanism, and this is going to basically fall down. So this is why you have to, so I apply load, I need to put a brace. So if you put the brace will help you take the lateral load. And when this tries to deflect, the brace will be activated and it will take the tension. Now I'm gonna do it. So suppose that, you know, this is a brace. And normally, you know, we put the braces diagonally. Okay, we put the braces diagonally. Okay, why? Because when they are in an angle and you pull them, they will take the lateral load. Okay, but when the load changes directions, because, you know, if this is a building, I need to be careful, okay, this is a building. If the load comes from this side, then this goes to compression and the brace will basically buckle. This particular one is a cable brace. We use cables in structures. Okay, so this is why in this case we like to put two. So now the problem is when you put two, because you are blocking things, this is what architects don't like, and this is why architects tell you we like open space, so you need frames. But if that's an industrial hall, normally the owner of the industrial hall does not care about openings. So the owner of the industrial hall will say, I would like to minimize the cost, so I don't need connections. I just need maybe a few moment connections where I need to put doors. So when you have this, you can calculate deflection, but in this case, you will have to disregard the brace that is going in compression, because we saw in this example I do here in class, that when an element takes compression, the compressive load can really make it buckle. Okay, so if you want to calculate deflections, this is really calculating, so this will come here. So this is going to rotate like this. So this is going to do this, and then this is going to come here. So if you want to calculate the deflection now, what you really need to do is you need to calculate how much the brace elongates. So we call this epsilon, elongation. Okay, so we call this epsilon. So to calculate this, if you know the force, maybe I can use colors. So you need to calculate how much is the traction in the brace, which is equal to this one. Okay, so the traction in the brace, it's very easy to calculate, because if you know the force, you come here. So if you want this, you know that this is
alpha, I call it. Alpha, yes, alpha, because that's alpha.
So if you want to calculate the traction in the brace, this will be F divided by cos A. Okay. Also, the other thing I need to know to calculate the elongation in the brace would be the length of the brace. But that I know. Okay, the length of the brace, if I know the length of the beam, will be length of the beam divided by cos A, because it's the same geometry. Okay. Now, so let me take this out for a minute. Okay, let me take this out for a minute. So I am dealing with the, I'm taking this out, so I'm cutting it. Okay, I'm cutting it. So essentially what I have is I have T that will make it elongate. Okay, we'll make it elongate. So if that's LB, this will become, let's say, LBR star. Okay. So I can clean this now. Okay. So if you want to calculate stiffness, you need to find the elongation first. Okay. So the elongation here is equal to force, axial force on the brace, divided by axial stiffness of the brace. So this is equal to axial force on the brace divided by EA over LBR. So that you've done before. Maybe you don't remember it. Okay. So if you have a member here with a cross section A, right? So this has a cross section A, and it's made out of a certain material. Then the axial stiffness of this is gonna be EA over L. Okay. So if I use this, epsilon here is basically T over EI times LBR. And I also do the substitution of this term here and this term here. Essentially, what I'm getting is that the brace elongation I'm interested to calculate is going to be equal to FLB divided by EA BR times cos square A. Okay. So I found the brace elongation. So if I know the brace elongation, I can go up here, calculate deflection. So the lateral frame displacement is simply E divided by cos A. So I can get that. And then if you play a little bit with trigonometry, you can get away from the angle and you can introduce just the lengths of your frame. Okay, but if you stop here and you know you just do a substitution here, you should be able to find deflections. Okay. So essentially that's it. So if you think about how you can calculate deflections and forces in frames, if you know how to deal with regular frames, walls, and frames with bracing, basically you know how to do everything. Okay. And not only that, you can also do a combinations of those. So let me explain. Combination of those. So where is the is this clear or okay? So the okay, let me see now combinations that I can do. So let me ask you this question now. Yeah, I mean, I think the next few slides, I mean, this is, we will do this later, okay, but oftentimes when you, before I show you what I want to show you, so oftentimes when you have a system like this, okay,
and you are putting a bracing here, one question that we need to answer is what is the maximum P, or what is the maximum gravity load that I can apply into this type of structure? So when you look at this problem, you say, you know, this looks very difficult. Okay, you know, how can I know this without using a software?
Well, if you if you have n columns, right? If you have n columns, and you know that all of them are stabilized by the brace, so essentially you're putting the braces because if you don't have them, everything will go. And you say, I need to increase the vertical load because, you know, it snows. I need to know, you know, how much snow can I get. So if you really know this, so the P total here will be the summation of all P's that you have. Okay, so you can, you know that the each member can take the Euler load, but if you don't know it, don't worry, because you will learn it in this class. So then what you can do here is that you can express the Euler load as a function of what I showed you earlier, and then if you solve this system with respect to pretty much the area that you need to sustain the load that you want to reach, then you can answer that question without using software. Okay. So if P critical larger than that, you can basically solve with respect to that, and then that's it. Okay, so it's not a very hard problem if you are building with braces. And this way, engineers like braced frames. Engineers like braced frames because they can do calculations like this by basically using very trivial statics and essentially no special software is required, so the office doesn't have to spend a lot of money for maintenance of these programs. But also it's good for you, because if you are using special software, you can also do hand calculations to verify. Okay, so now let me ask you some questions. Now,
let's see what I want to ask you now.
So suppose you have this case. So suppose you have plan view. This is a plan view with concrete slab. And I know that, you know, I'm going to be dealing with lateral load. And I know a couple of things. I know that, you know, I'm going to put stairs here, so I'm going to need walls. Okay. I know that maybe, you know, that's a building that I need access on this side, so I'm going to have to put a frame here. So that's going to be a three-bay frame, because I would like here doors so that a truck can come in. Okay. Also, we need the backup for evacuation. So I'm going to put a second stairs here. So I'm going to put walls. Okay, let me think about it now. So now the problem is that now I'm introducing torsion in the problem, because when this is pushed laterally, this wall and this wall will hold the structure. And because this side is a frame, it's going to deflect more than the others. Okay, so because I'm introducing torsion, how about if that's not a door, I'm gonna throw a brace here. So if I do this, then this becomes stiff. So when this comes in, the load will be held here and here, and it doesn't deflect a lot. Okay, and then the others, I don't need anything special. I can make them shear connections. So here, because I cannot have this, so here I'm gonna put a column, but I'm gonna have a shear connection. Here I'm gonna put a column. Okay.
how can I do this by hand? How can I calculate deflection by hand? Because I can. Say that's a single story building. How can I do deflection by hand? So that's a say it's a single story building like the ones I show you. So I claim that I can solve this problem by hand. I don't need SAP 2000 or I don't need like SAR, how do you call this program? Whatever. Or I don't need some other crazy programs that we use. So look at it, right? Look at it. Okay. So if this is concrete, so if this is a slab, right? So a slab means the following thing. Okay, so suppose that you know here, so this is a slab. I don't care about I'm very visual, you know, I like this sort of so you're gonna see this a lot. Okay. So if I push the slab in this direction and everything is symmetric, I don't care what's underneath. So if I push this, right, so what do you observe? So if I put one here, I get one on the other side. Okay, I don't care what's underneath. So if this comes here, right? So this will be one. Okay. Now so now I care what's underneath. Okay. So suppose that these are rigidly connected and I put one. Okay. What do you observe again?
You have zero and
no. No, like essentially what I observe is that if everything is connected to the slab, it's moving with the slab. Okay. So I understand. Like the problem here is that the base is not fixed. So essentially it's just translation. But I meant that everything is locked on the ground. Okay. So if you have a slab, essentially, and below the slab everything moves by delta, essentially this problem, although 3D, I can make it 2D because I cut down torsion. If torsion is a problem, but normally we don't design with torsion. We don't design structures to deform in torsion. If torsion is not a problem, what I can do is the following. So if this goes out by delta, and suppose that you know everything, this is a single-story structure that you know A is the height. So what I can do is that this wall and this wall, I take it out. So I put the wall here. So if you are putting F, you agreed that you know when I push this wall deflects by delta, so this thing is gonna do this, and this thing is gonna come out by delta. Okay, so that you know how to do, but this is not the only one. So this wall I put it here on the side. I'm doing this again. Okay, so this is also delta because everything that is connected to the slab moves at the top by delta. But because we have a depth, because we have a slab, right? So what happens is that you can connect these two with a rigid axial element. So here at the connection, there's no moment, okay? But if this deflects by delta, this deflects by delta, and this element basically makes the two go together, okay? Now, this is not gonna matter. This is not gonna matter because this has the largest moment of inertia perpendicular to the primary load. So this is gonna fall down. So you don't need to worry about this. Now I have the frame, okay. Or maybe, you know, I'm gonna take this wall. Okay, so I'm gonna bring it here, so it's gonna be the same. So it's going to be rigidly connected.
Rigid. You have that, which is that.
You don't need to put it if you want to, because they don't contribute anything to stiffness, because all of them are shear connections. But I mean, if that confuses you, you could do it. So shear connection, I have a column, shear connection, I have a column, shear connection. So when this deflects, it does what the other walls do, but this one just pushes everything like this, delta. And now I get the frame. So the frame is as follows. I have rigid, again, rigid. I have a frame here that at the ends has a braced frame, and in between I have this moment connection, moment connection, moment connection. Here. Here, let's put a pin, okay? So this one, moment zero here, moment zero here, the beam is gonna deflect in double curvature. Let's put pin connection here. The beam is gonna deflect like this. Then I have this, and the brace will be activated. Okay. So I made the 3D problem, 2D problem, okay. I put the whole thing in a train. That's a train, okay, and with some imagination, okay. The answer you need to answer is, the question you need to answer is, fine, you're telling us this, maybe we can calculate deflection, but how can I calculate V1 to design, V2 to design, V3 to design? This doesn't have anything. V4 to design and V5 to design. Well, we said that the load likes to go to the stiffer first. Okay, so if you know how to calculate this stiffness, okay, so V1 is gonna be K1 over K total times F, same. K5 over K total times F. Okay, any question? Yes.
So when you have the walls, the deformation is like this on the top, but we have a slab on top.
So yeah, I mean, the walls deform, but I mean, that's, I'm basically making it very excessive so that you can see, because the slab, obviously, the slab will, so what the slab does, the slab is connected with the wall, but the wall doesn't deflect. Well, it deflects like this, but it doesn't, I magnify the deflection because the slab has to somehow take that deformation.
So we consider the slab as...
Yeah, so the way to think about the slab connected to a wall is, so what you are saying is the following. Maybe let me change boards. Okay, so here's what you are asking, if I understand. Okay, so you have a wall, and at the top of the wall, say I have a concrete slab. And here I have something else. Okay. So this, if I understand what you're saying, here there's a moment. But how much do you think this moment is? Exactly. So if you put F here, right, this moment down here is gonna be a lot, F times the height. But this moment here, because this one is very flexible compared to the wall, although there is a some moment, partial moment here, this moment is going to be very minute compared to this one. Now, when the wall deforms, the slab has to be able to accommodate the deflection. So, I mean, okay, I did it too much, but... So here, this thing, what it's going to do is that it's going to try to bend a little bit and go on the other side. So here, that's why we put reinforcement. Okay, but this reinforcement, there will still be some cracking, but this reinforcement doesn't have to be a lot because although I draw the deflection like this so that you can see it, it's not really that much because walls, that's why we put them, because we want to cut down as much deflection as possible. What else? So, but in principle, if you cut down the torsion, you can solve it like this. Okay, now if there is torsion, that's a different story. But this is why you can still do things, but this way we have also software. Okay. So that we don't have to, you know, do everything. But we can do this, we can approximate torsion, you know, you can make this rotate, and then you can calculate the angle with respect to delta, and then you can somehow do it. Okay, so the exercise today is related to that. For instance, before you do the exercise, they will come in 2 minutes, but before you do the exercise, let me tell you a couple of other things that you haven't perhaps realized. Maybe you have realized it, but you know, for those of you that haven't, okay. So say that you know you have a frame. And here, I remove this. So say that this is 20. Say that this is about 20 meters. 20 meters. And this is maybe like, you know, 5. These things are not in scale, sorry. Okay. Now, if you want to build a beam like this, to take the deflection, if you talk to Professor Mutoni, he will tell you that this has to be pre-stressed concrete, okay? Because if you try to do this with conventional reinforced concrete design, the beam has to be, you know, really deep, okay? And then it's not very good. If you talk to me, I will tell you that you don't need pre-stressed concrete because you can make a truss, okay? You can make a truss. Like you say that, you know, here, if you think about this, I can take the 20 meters with a deep beam, but my beam is not going to be a concrete beam, so that it's going to be very difficult to construct it price-wise. I can make a truss, and the truss will provide the stiffness. Okay, so here, if I remove this, okay, so I'm going to make a truss, and it's going to look somehow. But if that's, say, 1 meter, then I can take the deflection with no problem. Okay. By 1.5 meters. Okay. This is why, for instance, in stadiums, you don't see concrete beams, you see this. Okay. You see trusses, because we can go to 100 meters, but deeper. But in 100 meters, the material we need to use, it's not going to be a lot. So I can still do I very large. So I can do large stiffness because I need the large stiffness to cut the deflection. Okay. So if you have this and you see a truss, Essentially, what I am telling you is that, or what you should think is that the stiffness of this thing is going to be very large, so you can say that this is approximately equal to infinity. Okay, so if I look at this, this is equivalent to this. Okay. So if you see a truss in a structure, like when I was a student, I was saying, oh, you know, it's a truss, how am I going to do it? But it's really, you know, it's not very difficult, because you just say, okay, the truss makes things infinite. I just have to deal with the columns. And then when I need to size the truss, I'm gonna worry about this, because I just need to calculate the axial load. I just need to size this for compression, and I just need to find the one that is the worst. Okay, but that's a not very difficult problem. The difficult problem is how to size the columns. Okay, so that's the other thing that this is today, in today's exercise. Okay, so you're gonna see a truss. If you see the truss, you know, it's just infinite stiffness. Okay, if you have a second story, and there is another truss, this is like this. So this goes like this, and this goes like this, and you just calculate delta 1, delta 2. Okay. So that's it for today. So next week we are going to talk about this, is a little revision, but maybe from a different point of view that you've seen it so far. Okay. Because I don't care that you do moment shear axial load with a decimal precision, because deflections are very critical. I would like that you are able to calculate deflection very quickly without software. Okay, and also I think, you know, this is interesting perhaps because you can simplify structures in your mind, because they're not that complicated. Okay, so I'll see you next week. So we have the exercise, you're going to, so what we do is we post the exercise solution after the end. For advanced steel design, we had a small problem in the sense we posted the solution at the same time, but it's okay, it doesn't matter though, because you are not graded based on the exercise. But normally we post the solutions at the at the end of the lecture. And I'll email you about some material, the videos and everything of the class. Okay.